Welcome to a stage session. First of all, the stage sessions are open to everybody. We talk about artist wellness, technique, professional development, art school, whatever it is you want to chat about. And remember, you don't have to speak during a stage session. You can just listen. But of course, we love hearing all of your voices. If you want to ask a question on voice, you'll see at the bottom, there is a raised hand icon. So if you click on that, that will show to me that you are requesting to speak. We do have a limit of one question per person. And if you would like to ask me a question by typing, you can just type that into the text channel and just make sure you tag me, because if you don't, I'm likely to not see it. We don't critique personal artworks during the stage session. If you would like access to the Patreon voice sessions, that is a place where we do regularly critique personal artwork. We do take a brief look at Art Along's artwork, if that was the most recent stream. Okay, so we have a typed question from Trent, who says, any tips for giving critique to art mediums we are not familiar with? For example, critiquing sculpture if we know nothing about it. It's really useful for people to hear from somebody who really doesn't have a lot of expertise. You can almost know too much about the process. Sculptors, we sympathize and cry with each other over our technical processes. And it's actually nice to have somebody look at the work and go, look, I don't care how long it took for you to cast this. I'm just going to evaluate it on its own. All the millions of people that go into museums across the world, and most of them don't have art history degrees, and yet their opinion is very valid.
Can you describe a little bit more about working with Patreon?
It's an incredible amount of work to get it up and going. We had a Patreon here at Art Prof for years. I'd get a new patron like once every 6 months. It was incredibly slow. Patreon really doesn't work if you don't offer rewards. And you have to make sure that the rewards are scalable.
Okay, so then would you recommend that something where I or any aspiring Patreon artist would develop a following and then open or start a Patreon?
You want to get started right away, because the thing is, if you wait to have a following, then people don't know that you have one. And then once you start getting fans, you say, oh, I've got a Patreon, and it's all ready to go. Just be prepared to get so few results for a long time. The effort is gigantic. So you have to ask yourself, is that time spent on the marketing, fulfilling rewards, is that really going to benefit you? Because it is work to send out those rewards. Okay, so we have a question from Brittany. I have a question about getting more involved with the local art community. There's an art studio for kids to go and learn about art close by. I'd love to volunteer there, but I've been out of the working world for a bit. I feel a little nervous about it. Any tips or pep talk about approaching something new? I think that's fabulous, Brittany, because local art communities are so important. And a lot of people don't realize this because they're not glamorous jobs. They don't pay huge amounts of money. And I think they're oftentimes severely underappreciated. But I can tell you, for a lot of local kids, that one art class that they took, it really could be what makes them love art. Contact them, because most of these community centers, they're desperate for people to help out. I mean, you could say to them, hey, can I just try one class and just see how it goes? So that way you're not upfront asking for a commitment. You're not saying, oh, I want to be with this class for 12 weeks. You could just say, hey, could I just come by one time, maybe for this workshop, see if it's a good fit. Trial periods are really good for something like that, because who knows, like maybe you'll go to the art center and you realize, you know what, this isn't a good fit for me. Let me do something else. And then it's not like you've made a commitment and you flaked out on it. Beyond that first class, you could say, oh, could I come for these three classes? And you can go into it a little bit more slowly. Worst case scenario is they go, no, sorry, we don't need anybody. And you go somewhere else. I would imagine that places like that really would appreciate you reaching out. Blue, can you join me on the stage?
Once you've completed a piece, how do you protect it? There's a whole bunch of varnishes, cold waxes, Do you put it under glass? How do you figure out what to do to protect each piece, especially if you're using different media?
The tip I would give about varnishing is before you varnish, take photos of the artwork, because paintings are already a pain to photograph. But when you put varnish, like shiny varnish, on an oil painting, it's horrible to photograph. I'll tell you, I don't varnish my paintings that much, because the only time when I'm really worried about that is if I'm selling the artwork to somebody or it's going into a collection. Even in exhibitions, I haven't really worried that much about it. So it's not something that you have to do. I do recommend it if you're going to sell to somebody, because it does protect the artwork. Putting things under glass really is not necessary. First of all, it's expensive. Second of all, it's really not helpful to be under glass unless it's in a frame, because then you're going to have the glass like pressing up against the artwork, which could be a problem. I think for dry media, some people use spray fixative. Some people don't. I don't use it because I just don't like that it darkens the drawing a little bit. It's minor, but I can see it and it drives me crazy. I don't know. Have you ever used spray fixative?
Yep. And it does darken. It does darken a soft pastel significantly, yeah, to the point where you say, oh, why did I do this?
For works on paper, it is ideal to have flat files. Most people don't have space. So what I do is I just buy those like really big, sturdy portfolio cases that they sell at art stores. It's pretty sturdy. And sometimes I'll sandwich sheets of newsprint in between pieces, or I'll make like folders to contain certain areas. It's a hassle. It's a lot of space that it takes up. Are you having trouble with storage?
Not yet, but I will.
Just give it like a year. You'll fill it up. Maya says, I've been scared of experimenting with different styles and stuff to draw. It's been dragging me from not doing any major work. Any tips or words about it? Indulge yourself. I know this sounds really weird. A lot of times I'm pushing people, okay, be ambitious, try all these different things and do things that make you uncomfortable, but you can't do that all the time. Once in a while, you got to put on your nice, soft, comfy sweatpants and just really feel comfortable and fine. I'm all into experimentation, but if it's stressing you out, that's not a good thing. And there's always going to be time for playtime. I had a student who said to me, oh, well, it's the summer and I just have been doing a lot of fan art and I just feel so guilty about it. And I said, well, what's the problem? And they're like, oh, I know I should be doing all these other things. And I was like, do you like the fan art? They're like, yes, I love it. It makes me feel so good and happy. I'm like, then do it. It's fine. Like, I just don't think that we should see ourselves as on a schedule to accomplishments or successes. I think that that can be really stressful for a lot of people. And just draw whatever you want to draw, no matter how silly you feel. You have to show it to anybody. Just put it in your sketchbook and just have a good time.
In order to get better at art, I know that you have to practice, and you have to practice regularly and often. But a lot of places kind of push the narrative that the moment you stop working, you start failing. When do you stop? When do you take a break?
If it makes you feel better, I took a break for 2 years. I was so burned out. In 2014, I had these two solo exhibitions simultaneously. I don't know what I was thinking. It was the dumbest thing now that I look back on it. And I was so stressed out for these shows that by the time I finished those two shows, I was just mad. I was resentful. So it really was not until 2 years later where all of a sudden I had this idea. I was like, oh my God, I have to make work right now. It was worth the wait. It was fantastic. I don't know, maybe I missed out on something, but I don't really care because I'm fine with the way it turned out. In the chat, Dorinka says, when following a career in the arts, do you recommend focusing on a specific area to improve your skills at a high level? Experiment with different industries to be a more, quote, knowledgeable artist. Do any of these options assure a sooner success as an artist? You never know. I'm sorry to tell you this, because there have been so many situations where I thought, oh, I have this in the bag. And I was, oh, guaranteed this. And it just didn't work out. I've had other situations where something just plopped into my lap and it was so incredibly easy. I think the important thing is you have to remind people that you exist. When I think about, oh, do I need to hire somebody for something? I'll be honest, I go through my Instagram and I look at who I follow. Yes, focusing on a specific area can be important, but it's also good to be a well-rounded artist. There is such a thing as being so specific that actually works against you. Like, I have a colleague in Boston who is the master lithographer. But the thing is, think about how many lithography teaching jobs are out there. There's so few. I mean, nobody teaches lithography in high school. I could be teaching in a department. Maybe I was hired to teach drawing. And then they go, oh, we need somebody to teach color. And I'm like, oh, I can do it. So sometimes having the broad range of expertise is important. Experimenting with different industries, it's a little bit harder to do because getting anywhere in an industry takes time. So if you say, okay, I want to try being a freelance illustrator, you have to do that for a while before you figure out if it's really going to work out for you. Because even people who are really good illustrators have trouble getting up and running. Some people just start right off the bat and get lucky. Keep an eye out for things. Like, I would never just look at your life and say, oh, I can only do this one thing and I won't think about anything else. Alex Rose said to me that he said that was his biggest mistake. When he graduated art school, he said, I just want to do book illustrations for middle grade. I was like, that's a really like specific area. And he said, you know, I really wished I had thought about other industries because it would have helped me some more.